Hey, what's up? My name is Chris Trini, and welcome to Kriscoart. Today we're going to look at 5 tricks that can improve the flow of your edit. Number 1, adding camera movement. Now, the way you can add camera movement in most editing apps is by adding keyframes to whatever value you want to change over time. When you're adding keyframes, you want to set an in point and you want to set an out point for your animation. So your in point is the value at which it starts and your out point is the value at which it ends. Now in Premiere, the way you do this is you go on the VFX and controls panel and you can click the stopwatch icon next to whatever property you want to change. And then from there, you can animate the position, the scale, or anything else that you want. So you might want to do this because sometimes a shot can feel a little bit too static, but you want to be careful with this because even a subtle tiny bit of adjustment in movement can really drastically change the meaning and the feel of a shot. And also the speed and the direction that you're punching in can drastically affect your audience's focus. So you can really dial in what elements and what subject you want your audience to pay attention in your composition by pushing in subtly and also adding a direction to your push. Now the way you do this is simply by animating the scale to punch in as well as the position. So when you're animating the scale over time, you can also animate the position and reframe your shot to wherever you want to dial that focus in. Number 2 is stabilizing your footage with keyframes. Now, we probably know the trick of warp stabilizer. You know, you just drag and drop it onto a clip, and then from there, it kind of stabilizes or does the best job that it can do. But sometimes, when you're going a little bit too handheld, or even if you want to keep that handheld vibe to your shot, sometimes warp stabilizer just doesn't do the trick. So, what I've done in this past drawer is I've actually animated the position of the up and down position whenever there was a little bit too much headroom, or you know, when the camera was just jerking up a little bit too much. And you can reframe your shot this way, but you can also stabilize your shot. So for example, when the camera is kind of bobbing up and down a little bit too much, you can compensate that movement by animating the position and just going the opposite direction of where your physical shot is going, if that makes any sense. So if your camera is going a little bit too much up and then down, you want to animate the clip going down as the camera is going up, and then animate the clip going up as the camera is going down. Yes. It's a little bit confusing, but when you counteract that movement, you're actually stabilizing the clip just a bit. You know, if you do it too much, it becomes a little bit too jarring. But if it's solid enough, it can definitely improve your shot. Now, another way of doing this, if you don't have that vertical room, if you're not, you know, going for a cropped in look, you can always just punch in a little bit and then you have that extra room to move your clip up and down. Number 3 is faking continuity. Now, this one requires a little bit of After Effects work, but it's really, really simple stuff. In this particular shot, there was an issue where it just felt like it was kind of a jump cut to a random B-roll clip of this headlight. There wasn't really anything that tied it into the rest of the sequence. So what I did is I actually borrowed a little bit of this piece of cloth that is doing this big reveal of the car, and I actually animated it over the headlight in order to tie it into the previous and following shot. So this was very simple. I just masked a section of that piece of cloth that was borrowed from the other clip, and then I just simply animated it going out of frame in this close-up, and I also added a camera lens blur and animated that in order to match with the sort of rack focus onto the headlight. Number 4 is removing reflections, and this is another VFX trick that I thought was worth mentioning because it has saved me so many times, and you never know when you're gonna run into reflection issues. The original clip actually had quite a drastic reflection of me doing whatever I'm doing reflected as well as some of the crew in the background. So the way I eliminated this was by using the clone stamp tool. Now for this, you're gonna wanna use Photoshop. So to do that, we're gonna export a single frame of our reflection and we're gonna bring that into Photoshop where we're gonna use the clone stamp tool. You're gonna use the Alt key on your keyboard to just sample a part of the reflection that doesn't have any people in it. And then you just start making your way and drawing bits and pieces until you finally eliminate the full reflection. Now this can be tracked back into your shot if your shot is moving. In my case, it's just a static shot, so it was just as simple as adding that section back in, masking it out, feathering it, you know, making sure that it matches, and then finally adding camera blur and animating it if you're going into focus onto the reflection, or just making sure that it's at the same blurriness level as the rest of your shot. All right, and finally, number five is adding lights and shadows. Now, this is something that I've talked about before in other videos, but it is worth mentioning again because it's a trick that I use over and over, and I actually used it in this shot. So we went from this to this with this simple trick. And if you've seen any of my other videos, like Get the Film Look and After Effects or whatever titles they have, it's essentially the same trick. You create some solids and some masks, and you use whatever is present in your scene to kind of cut these shapes and shape the light. Now, if you are interested in this sort of technique and want to just dive deeper in, I have about like two or three videos at this point that just cover it extensively. So make sure to check the info cards, and I'll also leave a link to those videos in the description. Now, as a bonus, I want to tell you a really excellent source for music, and that is Filmstro. That is what I used in the short. Now, there are a ton of royalty-free music websites out there, but what makes Filmstro unique is that you can actually control some of the parameters and some of the layers of these different tracks. Now, in last week's short that I keep referencing back to, I really wanted to hit certain points musically. There was certain moments where you really needed to dial in the attention in terms of music, or bring up the emotion, or bring up the momentum, and these are all parameters and sliders that you can control and animate in the Filmstro window, even right inside of Premiere. So if you guys are interested in Filmstro, they're not paying me to say this, I really recommend it as a tool for music and adding some quick scores to some of your shorts or some of your videos. Definitely check them out. And if you use the link in the description, you get 20% off. All right, guys, I hope you enjoyed this. If you wanna see more of these kind of videos, even related to editing, let me know. I might make another 5 editing tricks that I often find myself using. We haven't even touched audio, I mean, with the exception of Filmstro and music, but there are so many different little editing tricks that you can do in terms of audio, and that can significantly improve the flow of your edit. We haven't talked about pacing, we haven't talked about, you know, the storytelling within the timeline of when you're piecing things together. That can all come if you guys want to. Let me know what you're interested in seeing next. Anyways, my name is Chris Trini for Kriscoart. If this is your first time on this channel, consider subscribing for more content like this. And if you did enjoy this video, give it a like. Thank you guys, I'll see you next time.